Welcome back to our series of online talks and lectures being hosted by Aligarh Society of History and Archaeology, ASHA, along with its social media partner, Ganga Jamuni Heritage. We deal with with Mughal sources each Friday. While we discuss reflections on our shared past, as well as medieval Indian society on every Sunday. The last mentioned theme is something which we started just a few weeks back. Our endeavor is to put before you all not only our shared heritage and culture, but also how to approach our historical past through a scientific and secular approach by understanding our sources of information and how to analyze them. Today, in our 28th lecture, we would be dealing with an aspect of the Mughal society. We have already dealt with aristocracy when Dr. Raghavan spoke about Abdul Rahim Khan Khanan. We also have had a lecture on Kabir, who was a bhakti saint. Now, we would deal with the mercantile classes as a social entity. And for that, we have with us my friend, Professor Najaf Haider, who teaches at the School of Historical Studies, JNU. We have had Professor Haider once before as well. Sometimes back, he had delivered a scintillating lecture on a petty trader, Banarsi Das, and his autobiography, Ardh Kathanak. Today, he would be speaking in general about the merchants and money lenders. All of you know about Najaf Haider, a well-known and widely traveled historian who has worked on the Mughal coins. I recall one of his papers where he elucidated on the method of how the coins were minted during the Mughal period. He is one of the rare scholars of medieval Indian history today who actually knows the Persian language. Unfortunately, there are not many scholars left today about whom this claim might hold true. He is a rare breed who has combined the new historiographical tools with the traditional approach of the Aligarh school. Amongst his research interests are fields like history of money, banking, credit, and international exchange, history of book production and circulation, history of secretarial classes, as well as history of Delhi. He has been a visiting professor at University of Bonn and University of Vienna. In 2014, he had also been Erasmus Mundus Fellow at Vienna. His visiting fellowships include those at Oxford, Suez, and at MSH in Paris. His CV also includes an INLAC fellowship. Author of numerous research papers and articles, and having a DPhil from Oxford, Professor Najaf Haider is a very down-to-earth person. His wit and humor too is legendary. And above all, he is a dear friend. Over to you, Najaf.
Thank you very much, Professor Razavi, for your kind words, and thank you, Shagufta, for the platform to speak on a subject which is on which I have been working for some time and have published something, Merchants and Money Lenders, Merchants and Money Changers in Medieval India. I have a PowerPoint which I would like to share with you. I hope there is no problem with that.
So let me help you.
Yeah. Yes, please.
So if you turn your PowerPoint on.
Yes.
And then at the bottom of the screen, it says share screen.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, if you can just email the PowerPoint to me, it'll be faster and easier.
It says StreamYard.
If you just share the screen.
Yeah.
And then it'll ask you for application. It says your entire screen and then application window. Please click on application window.
Okay. When it says your entire screen. Okay. Yeah.
Application window. Please click on application window and select your PowerPoint.
Yeah, I'm trying to do that. It's showing the whole screen.
No, then you have to click on the next one. There is another tab to it next to it, application window.
Entire screen.
And right next to that is application window.
Just a second. Okay, let's do it again. Share screen. Yeah. So now it's sharing the screen, but it's not sharing my PPT. I would like.
So may I request you to share your PPT? Just send it to me over email and you can start talking. I'll share your PPT from my end.
But can you see it now?
No.
No, I cannot.
Okay, you cannot see. Okay.
So you can start the topic and I can share the screen on my end.
You just email it to her.
Okay, I'm going to do that. Okay, let me quickly email. I'm sorry about the delay.
Well, friends, till Professor Najaf Faidar is able to show his PowerPoint and deliver the lecture, let me mention to you the programs which are scheduled after this lecture. And we have next week Professor Shirin Musvi, who would be meeting us on 29th of January and would be speaking about Aine Akbari. On 31st of January, that is Sunday, next Sunday, we would be having Professor Irfan Habib, who would be talking about the village community. With its members like zamindars and the peasants. So next week, be prepared for these two giants. Najaf, by now, I think your PowerPoint might have reached her. So yeah, let us do your lecture. And
I've sent the PowerPoint presentation, and. Yeah. I'll start speaking.
Yeah, and you can start now, and we will then.
Because there are images in the PPT.
Yeah. I mean, within 5 minutes, 2 minutes, or 3 minutes, we'll start with that.
So no problem.
In the meantime.
So I would like to begin with an introductory point, which is that there is a contrast which historians and economists often envisage between exchange economy and subsistence economy. This contrast can be seen more or less in our own society today also, although in lesser measure, in which in the subsistent part of the economy, there is very little which we can call exchange. And here the word exchange is a technical term which is employed to characterize any transaction between two parties which are selling and buying goods. Goods technically mean marketable products with prices and use of money. In subsistent economies, there is no direct involvement of any intermediary, either money or merchant. The peasants produce and consume. They are also artisan because there is household production of craft goods, which is again consumed or barter. And therefore, there is hardly any exchange of the kind that economists call market economy or economy involving merchants and money. In many parts of the country in medieval India, and even today, we have village servants and artisans working for the village, either for a household or for the entire village, in exchange for grain or a piece of land or some form of payment, which is considered traditional. Some people call it jajmani system, but it's an example of subsistence economy. The other kind of economy is exchange economy. And it is in this economy that you have merchants. As a professional class which exists in societies with exchange of goods and services, either, which is generally less, in a way that can be characterized barter, or generally for cash money, coins in those days, or credit papers. So it's fair to say that merchants exist only in an exchange economy where the relationship between the producer and the buyer is not direct. And the immediacy of this relationship is broken by the existence of an intermediary. Next, please. Can I do it on my own, or can I change slides on my own, or?
I'm afraid not, sir.
Okay.
I'll have to do it.
Yeah. So can you put it on full without this thumbnails? Yeah, thank you so much. Now, one very important feature of medieval Indian economy, which has been highlighted by the researches of historians like Professor Irfan Habib, is the existence of exchange economy driven largely by the practice of the state to collect revenue in cash. And there are two things which are important here. First, the amount that is collected by the state in revenue is large. It's not a small amount. It's not a tax like today. And I'm not talking about income tax. It was large, and it is sometimes, broadly speaking, on an aggregate scale, pitched at half of the produce. The second point is that this produce is converted into cash. That is to say, the state demands its claim from its subjects, mostly peasants, in money, which it needs for to pay for its own expenses. So there is the presence of a state which monetizes taxation and spends money on its own apparatus triggers a cycle, an economic cycle of exchange economy. Imagine every season, and there are two seasons in our economy, when large quantities of grain and other products, craft products, raw material for craft products, like indigo, sugarcane, other forested products, wax, honey, lac, are taken to the market and paid and sold in the market to earn cash for revenue payment. Now, we should keep this in mind because this has been the structural feature of the medieval economy. Throughout its 500 years, let's say from 1200 AD to 1800 AD, 1700 AD, or 1800 AD, this has been the outstanding feature of the economy. What Professor Habib has called state-driven commerce. This does not happen in a society where peasants and artisans sell directly to the market, which, by the way, was also the case in medieval India, where there were many rich peasants who crafted products with the help of their family labor, who sold for the market regardless of the claim of the state. So in fact, there were two streams, and it is fair to say that the stream driven by the state, demand of the state, was much bigger, much larger. The merchants acted a very important link between the producer, taxpayer, and consumer. More often than not, the consumers were also recipients of the tax money. So it is fair to say that money was made in the countryside but consumed in the town, because the Mughal ruling classes, the medieval ruling classes, lived in cities, and not unlike, let us say, the Sasanian bureaucracy, which was rural in character. Medieval Indian ruling classes, and by that I mean imperial ruling classes, there were two ruling classes, local ruling classes, which were hereditary and more deeply attached to the soil, and the imperial ruling class, which was centered at imperial cities, districts, sub-districts, and received a lion's share of the state claim. The merchants were professionals. This was their business, for which they charge, you can call it commission, mercantile profit, merchant capital, a more significant term to which we shall return later. Next, please. Here I would like to quote two statements from the French traveler Tavernier, who came to India many times between 1640 and 1666. The first quotation: it is not necessary that those who travel in India should provide themselves with food beforehand, that is to say, they don't have to carry anything. Because even in the smallest village, rice, flour, butter, milk, sugar, and other sweetmeats, dry and liquid, can be procured in abundance. That is to say, there were shops and there were sellers. The second quotation is, a village in India may indeed be very small if it had no money changer. That's also an interesting quotation. Meaning that you have another professional class apart from merchants, money changers who were present in large part of the country, even in villages. Put together, the two quotations give us a picture of a countryside which is not entirely autarkic, but where there were shops and merchants, money was used, multiple currencies were used, and as we shall see soon, money changers existed to handle the different kind types of money currencies used in the market. Next, please. Now, we are using merchants and money changers as units of professional groups. But within these units, there was a great variety. There were different types of merchants and there were different types of money changers. In the 14th century, the Chishti Sen, Sheikh Nasiruddin Chiragh, made this very interesting statement. A merchant, Bakal, needed three things as capital. Maya, from which we have the term sarmaya, for trade. Namely, money, maal, shop, dukan, and commodities, kumash. The plural, akhbasha. Now, it's a very simple definition, but it's a basic requirement for anyone to be called merchant. There were small merchants, such as shopkeepers or grocers, who had, as we saw in Tavernier's quotation, shops in villages, and similarly, as we shall see also in towns. And these were the largest in number. So we must understand that any discussion on the mercantile class of medieval India must first begin with this basic level of shopkeeping and selling in different manners with small capital, small number of goods, sometimes a shop, but sometimes no shops, because there were itinerant merchants who moved from place to place with their merchandise and put it on display on a piece of cloth called bisat, a term which we still use today, though in a different sense. And on the bisat, the bigger the bisat, the bigger the status of the merchant. Hence the term, tumhari kya bisat. I would also like to include another category of merchants who were itinerant but not small, called banjaras or grain merchants. Now, in our earlier picture, when we saw the state extracting a large quantity of grain from the countryside in revenue towards the local mandi. For sale, it was the Banjaras who facilitated this sale. They were the ones who supplied the grain from the countryside to the town. Towns, as you know, by definition, do not produce their own food grain and had to rely on the supply from the countryside. And these supplies were brought by Banjaras, who operated in large numbers. The group existed in India since the time of Alauddin Khilji, where it is described as Karwanian, because they travel in caravans with their family, packed animals. They knew their way. They had their halt stations called tandas, and they knew the markets very well where they had to sell their produce. And after finishing one cycle, they would come back to the village in the next season after the harvest is done and would carry a fresh supply of grain to the town. Professor Habib has written given an excellent account of this group of very important group of merchants called Banjaras. The term Banjara today has a different meaning, obviously, because that kind of trade, grain trade, is extinct now, particularly after the introduction of railways or other transport systems in India. But in those days, this was a major, major institution, mercantile institution for bringing grain and other products, or agro products, if you like, from the countryside to the town. Next, please. Let us look at, stay for some time with this small merchant community, because we have so much, we know so much about big merchants. They are always written about because there are more sources. Of course, although one still laments that in India we hardly have accounts of merchant families, their ledgers, their letters, etc. Now, here you have Banarsi Das. Once again, I had the occasion to speak on Banarsi Das's autobiography, The Arth Kathanak, in a different series on this platform. Banarsi Das was 24 when he started his first business venture from Jaunpur to Agra in 610 AD. And his father, Khadaksen, borrowed money by writing a hundi. Something like 200 rupees, and bought loose gems, jewel studded objects, jadao objects, wristlets or pahunchi, rings, manik, mani, neelam, panna, chunni, omitted, 20 mud of ghee and 2 bags of oil, perfumed oil or phulal, and a dukul or fine muslin of Jaunpur. This is a typical small merchant. Little capital, some family money, but a large part borrowed through an instrument of a credit instrument called hundi. And Banarsidas takes this to Agra, keeps it in different places, warehouses, and goes every day to the main market on Nakhas and sells. He doesn't have a shop. I am assuming that in the main market of Agra, where he was selling his goods, he was either spreading a sheet and putting everything on there, or using some space, borrowed space from a shopkeeper who was known to him, or even renting space. We don't know. He doesn't tell us. But if you look at this entire transaction, you get a picture of a small merchant who is dealing with broadly two kinds of goods. One, in which his family generally specialized, his father Kharaksen and other members of the family, like his grandfather's brother, were jewelers. But here, the father puts other things also, ghee, oil, and fabric, with an understanding that there are two types of markets, one for jewelry and one for these merchandise, and perhaps Banarsidas will have greater latitude in selling these goods. So if there is no demand for one, another can be sold, and the first can be sold later. Next, please. Well, I do not have any painting of Agra of 1610 AD, or for that matter, 17th century. So here you have two paintings. The painting on the left-hand side is an imaginary painting. That is to say, it is from Saadi's Kulliyat, the famous poet Saadi Shirazi's Kulliyat, where there is a fight in the market. But for us, we can see how the market looked like. The cloisters within which goods were kept. And there is a man who is standing outside the cloisters, because he doesn't have one of his own, much like Banarsidas. And goods are being sold. The one on the right hand side is a historical painting, in the sense that it depicts a historical scene, although one must admit that there is a good deal of imagination involved even in this painting. Is of Fatehpur Sikri, and Professor Rizavi, who has a book on Fatehpur Sikri, would instantly recognize the scene where there are merchants who are selling their wares and there are people who are buying, and some are eyeing. So these two paintings are illustrative of the kind of market we had different kinds of markets, but two characteristic forms were cloistered markets or closed markets. One good example is Shah Jahanabad, where two long streets, one running from the fort's Lahore gate to the Lahore gate of the city, called Chandni Chowk today, and the other running from the Agra gate of the fort, Red Fort, to the Agra gate of the city, today called Delhi gate. Both these streets had shops. They were lined with shops, with similar cloisters, as you see in the first painting. Whereas in many other parts, there were open shops where things were sold in the open. Next, please. Now, let us keep Banarsi Das's business ventures in mind and move up the hierarchy to look at a big merchant. In fact, many big merchants, and as we saw, big merchants, by big merchants I mean those who had a large amount of capital with which they could purchase different kinds of services, servants, factors, agents, warehouses, etc., as we shall see later. Many of these merchants had family firms. Businesses conducted with the help of the family. In fact, even Banarsi Das's family could have had a firm, had the father and the son, Khadak Sen and Banarsi Das, worked together, pooled their resources together. But that did not happen. Unfortunately, Khadak Sen had to work elsewhere, Jaunpur, Allahabad, and Banarsi Das had to work mostly in Agra, but also in places like Patna, Jaunpur, Banaras, and for a short period of time, Allahabad. But this is a family firm. The head of the family firm is a man called Nemi Sah, who is a big merchant of Agra and head of the family firm. He has two sons, Sabal Singh Mothia and Tara Chand Mothia. In 1614 AD, Tara Chand Mothia engaged Banarsi Das to go to Patna to do business as his agent. He gave him money, Rashi, put a tilak on his forehead and got him across the river. Made arrangements for him to cross the Yamuna and be on his own. What happened thereafter is another interesting story. But in 16 AD, 2 years later, when Banarsi had spent a lot of time in Jaunpur and a lot less in Patna where he should have been, he receives two letters from Sabal Singh, who is now the heir, who is the head of the firm now, that he should come immediately to Agra to close his accounts. And Banarsi went to Agra, where he waited for something like 3 days or 3 months, I can't right now remember. But he waited and waited. Why? Because Sabal Singh was having a party. Music and dancing and celebration. So here you have the family of a big merchant who have large capital, who can hire people to go as far as Patna to trade, and who have an organized system of accounting where they have to. In fact, Banarsi Das was wanting not to go to Agra and finish his commitment, but they insisted, you must come and sign. And he had to go and sign. And that's how the whole thing was legally closed. So it's interesting that in this same time period, within a shared space, you have these two types of merchants, one small and the other big. Next, please. Can I have the next, please? Next slide, please. Then I move finally to the third type of merchants. Maritime merchants. Much of the trade in medieval India was inland trade. That is to say, trade conducted within the on land, within the confines, frontiers of the country or the empire, even though it involved crossing the river, as we saw in the case of Vanarsidas. And in fact, riverine traffic was a very important component of inland trade. But here we are talking about merchants who did business outside India. That is to say, they had their factors and agents stations in different parts of the world, of the known world. While they were stationed in India, maritime trade was by definition long distance trade. To some extent, you can imagine this trade, sometimes also called international trade, sometimes called overseas trade. And if you combine overseas and caravan trade, you get the full picture of international trade. International is a loose term that I am using. If you conceptualize this trade, it is virtually an extension of inland trade, except for that the size of the merchandise is big. There are many people involved. The time span is much longer for the full cycle to complete. And of course, the risks are higher. Such merchants possess goods of high value, karkhanas or workshop from where they could make their own goods if they did not want to purchase it from different artisans. There they had warehouse come office called koti. The Europeans call it factory. So we have English factory, Dutch factory. They had branches or dukan. Dukan in the sense of branches and not shops. Agents of Akil and of course ships. Or if they did not have ships, they could rent space, large space in an outgoing ship. These ships sailed to the Red Sea, where there were two important ports, first Aden and then later Mocha, to the Persian Gulf, first to Hormuz and then to Bandar Abbas, to Southeast Asia, through the Straits of Malacca, sometimes all the way to China, Philippines, an Indian merchant of Armenian origin had ships going to Philippines, and of course Europe. Indian merchants did not send their ships directly to Europe, but European merchants came after the discovery of the direct route they came, bringing their ships and carried Indian goods directly to Europe. Before that, and also at the same time, Indian goods traveled through a combination of maritime and caravan routes to Europe across the Mediterranean. The famous Levantine route, where both the Persian Gulf and Red Sea caravans met in places like Baghdad, Damascus, and Aleppo, and carried across the river, across the Mediterranean, to places like Venice and south of France. So this was a large network involving huge capital and interesting dealings. We are lucky to have details of the dealings of these merchants over goods, prices, modes of payment, time required for payment, etc. The two famous merchants of Surat, which was a very important port, were Virji Vora and Mullah Abdul Ghafur. There is hardly any account of 17th century Surat trade which is complete without the names of these two big merchants. Mullah Abdul Ghafur owning ships and Virji Vora's total asset estimated at 80 lakhs rupees in the 1660s. Then, of course, there were foreign merchants. Armenian, very large number of Armenian merchants within the foreign community of foreign merchants, also divided into big merchants and small merchants. Big merchants with lot of capital and connections with officials, nobles, and small merchants. One small merchant, who was a factor actually, John of Julfa, has left a diary of his travel and trade in the 17th century, which is a valuable source of information for any historian of Mughal trade, both international and inland. Julfa was the homeland of Armenian merchants in Armenia. But when Shah Abbas relocated them in the suburbs of Isfahan, the term New Julfa was used for the locality. And Armenians who came from New Julfa called themselves Julfaline Armenians. So they never forgot their homeland. Then, of course, there were Iranian merchants, Turkish, Dutch, English, and other European merchants who were much smaller in size and trading operations. It's important to remember that by a rough calculation, the trade of the Dutch and English East India combined was less than 20% of the total international trade of Mughal India in the 17th century. And even in that, the share of the English was almost half of the Dutch. So the historiography which we have, in fact, gives us a very distorted picture of the presence of these merchants and their scale of operation. But do remember that these were very small entities in the Indian Ocean trade at this time. Conversely, there was a diaspora of Indian merchants in Yemen. Professor Ashin Das Gupta has written an excellent essay on Indian merchants in Yemen. Isfahan, something like 10 to 20,000 merchants, Indian merchants in Isfahan in the 17th century. And an Indian diaspora on the Caspian, particularly Astrakhan, on which Dale, Frederick Dale, has written a book, a very, very interesting book. And of course, we have other writers like Scott Levy's work on Central Asia and how Indian merchant operated in that region. So you have in India a community of foreign merchants, and you have in foreign lands, if you allow me to use this term diaspora, which is a very modern term, and frankly, historians are very hesitant to use this term, but there is no alternative, of diaspora of Indian merchants in different parts. And I haven't covered Southeast Asia, China, and Japan, but there were Indian merchants there too, although in smaller numbers. Next, please. Well, all of you are familiar with this famous painting, purely, entirely imaginary, in which Jahangir is embracing Shah Abbas of Iran. But what is important to us is the map which is given below on the globe. Next, please. This map shows us the places which existed in those times and of course exist today, which are germane to our discussion of India's long-distance maritime trade, such as Surat on the western coast, Goa, first under the Portuguese occupation, later on English, Golconda, or if you go further down below Goa, of course, the Malabar coast and Calicut, a very celebrated port. Then on the eastern side of Coromandel coast, Masulipatnam, further up Hooghly, further north of Surat, Thatta, a very important port or entreport if you like. Many of these places were not ports technically because they were not right on the bank, but they were entreports very close to the sea and goods could be easily transported, like Surat, using boats in the river Tapti, and in the case of Thatta, Indus. The map on the top also has places which can be identified as places where Indian goods went. The two gulfs, Persian Gulf on the eastern side and Red Sea, and East Africa, let's not forget East Africa. East Africa was very well connected with both Sindh and Gujarat and Western Deccan, and a very a different group of merchants, Gujarati merchants and East African merchants, were involved in this particular specialized trade lane. Next, please. This is a map of the city of port of Surat. Where you can see the city with the Qila or fort of Surat in the middle, and to the right of it, the Furza or customs house, where all the goods landed. In between is the river Tapti, and you have ships sailing with passengers and pilgrims, and also small boats to Jeddah. And from Jeddah, of course, pilgrims would go to Mecca, and merchants would carry on further to the southern tip of the Sinai Peninsula and other ports, from where Levantine merchants or European merchants will take over. Next, please. Now, this picture was of a professional class divided into different types based on the scale of their operation and possession of capital. But let's also look at them as a social entity. What kind of a social class was it? Well, it's a very interesting class in that sense. It's a community of merchants. It's also a caste. It has subcastes. And of course, it has, very importantly, specialization. So you can imagine the whole mercantile community as a single entity doing all those basic things that we have been discussing, down to a very specialized kind of a merchant who deals only in one commodity. If we historicize this conceptualization, there were two major mercantile communities in medieval India: Baniyas and Khatris. Now, the Baniyas had a much larger presence in northern India and Gujarat, and Khatris in Punjab. Some of these Khatri merchants were possibly Multanis, who we come across in the account of Alauddin Khilji's price regulations and trade arrangements. He dealt with two groups, Karwanians or Banjaras and Multanis. To the Multanis, he extended a loan of a large amount of tankas, or silver coins, with the arrangement that they would bring a whole range of commodities from far off markets to Delhi to service the various markets of Delhi, where his army and imperial camp was located, and the suburbs of Delhi. Of course, the army was also located in the suburbs. Now, these two communities coincided with the Vaishya and Kshatriya caste of the traditional hierarchy in Hinduism, although not in the same order. The Kshatriyas were higher than Vaishyas in the traditional order. And of course, there are some very interesting rivalry between the two as to who was superior in the hierarchy. What is more important is that their representation in our sources is as communities, also as castes, but largely as communities, as we shall see. For instance, the Jains of central India and Rajasthan, particularly Marwadis, were all called Baniyas, which means that they have in some way, in their own way, absorbed the traditional caste hierarchy prevalent among the Hindus. In the history, in a local history of Gujarat, Mirat-e-Ahmadi, there is a common list for the 84 subcaste of Maheshwaris or Maheshwari and Shravaks. First, Vaishnavites, second, Jains, all called Banik or Baniya or Bakkal. So you can see that, and in Iran, all Indian merchants were called Baniyas, regardless of their provenance, including Multanis. The Arabic-Persian term Bakkal, which we confronted right in the beginning, in the conversation of Nasiruddin Chiragh, which actually literally meant grain merchant in India. In Iran, it meant greengrocer, a fruit seller, soon became a generic term for baniyas. So whenever you have, you want to use the term baniya and you don't want to use it, you'd use the term bakkal. Now, within the baniya community, there was a specialization based on profession, professional specialization, which is also a very interesting story of how people branched out in different ways. Some became jewelers, such as Shantidas of Ahmedabad, a very famous, very reputed rich jeweler, and his family. Well, remember, Kharaksen was also some kind of a jeweler. But Shantidas was jeweler par excellence. And there were others who dealt in whichever commodity fetched higher prices or profit, such as Veerji Vohra and Abdul Ghafoor and Zahid Beg and others. Another stream of baniyas became brokers or dalal and money changers or sarraf. Remember, both dalal and sarraf are not Indian language terms. These are terms which have come from Arabic into Persian and then became prevalent and commonplace. Now we have the anglicized version, sharaf, for sarraf. Generally speaking, all merchants knew a bit of everything. Dalali, sarrafi, accounting, they were taught everything. And that brings us to a very interesting passage in Banarsi Das's Arkathanak. Next, please. Nadeem bhai, please warn me of the...
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, I'll be very quick because now we are transiting from merchants to money changers. There is a very interesting passage in Banarsi Das's Arkathanak, which I would like to recite and explain. Aath baras ko balak bhayo, tab chat saal padhan ku gayo. Padhi chat saal bhayo vyutpan, parkhay rajat takka sovan. Geh uchapati likhe banai, atto jama kahe samujhai. लहना देना विधि सौ लिख है बैठे हाट सर्राफी सिख है. सो हियर यू हैव एन 8 इयर्स ओल्ड मर्चेंट सन हुज फादर खड़कसेन वाज अ मर्चेंट हु वाज सेंट टू प्राइमरी स्कूल वेयर ही लर्नड व्हाटएवर ही हैड टू लर्न. ही इवॉल्वड, ही बिकेम क्लेवर, भयो व्युत्पन्न. Then what he does, he tests money. Parkhe rajat takka sovan. He is testing the value of silver, copper and gold money, gold currencies. And then he keeps accounts. He learns accounts. And mathematics involved in accounting. लहना देना विधि सौ लिखे बैठे हाट सर्राफी सीखे. सो इन दिस यू कैन सी दैट द ट्रेनिंग विच वॉज गिवन टू अ यंग मर्चेंट बॉय. इनफैक्ट बनारसी दास वॉज अ रिलक्टेंट मर्चेंट. हिज हार्ट वॉज मोर इन टू रीडिंग and studying, particularly poetry. And we should thank him for that, because he has left us with a wonderful versified autobiography. It's remarkable. We do not have any versified autobiography. We have other versified accounts. But his parents, elders of the family, prevailed upon him by saying, Padhna likhna brahmano ka aur bhat ka kaam hai. Merchants, a merchant's son should first go and sit in the shop and start learning the tricks of the trade. And of course that happened. And even though Banarsidas was not a successful merchant, he, in his account, has given us some very interesting experiences of the market and the various merchants he came across. Next, please. This is my last slide for the merchants, which is some kind of a carryover from the previous slide. It's a quotation by Tavernier about Baniyas, their education, their skill, and their demeanor. The third caste in the hierarchy, that is, the traditional Indian hierarchy, is that of Baniya, who attach themselves to trade, some being sharofs, money changers or bankers, and the other brokers, by whose agency merchants buy and sell. The members of this caste are so subtle and skillful in trade that they could give lessons to the most cunning Jews. They accustom their children at an early age to shun slothfulness, and instead of letting them go into the streets to lose their time at play, as we generally allow ours. A very interesting comparison between European and Indian children. They teach them arithmetic, which they learn perfectly, using for it neither pen nor counters, but the memory alone, so that in a moment they will do a sum, however difficult it may be. They are always with their fathers, who instruct them in trade. So you can see that the family plays a very important role in the profession, who instruct them in trade and do nothing without at the same time explaining it to them. They use the same figures in their books, both in the empire of the great Mughal as well as in other parts of India, although the languages may vary. A very interesting observation, which means that there was a single Indian accounting system. And no matter which language you used, they written in Devanagari or some other language, and even in the languages which were written in the Devanagari script, you have a variety of languages. The system of accounting will be the same. And this statement can be validated with the help of other evidence. But I found this particular observation in Tavernier very, very instructive. If anyone gets in a rage with them, and this we should read and reread, if anyone gets in a rage with them, they listen with patience. Very hard for me to do. Without replying, and withdraw coldly, not returning to see him for 4 or 5 days. When they anticipate, his rage will be over. Abhi bhi hum kehte hain na, gussa thanda ho jane do, phir baat karte hain. Exactly that. So this is a very nice quotation in which Tavernier, who himself was a jeweler and who spent a lot of time in India in the second half of the 17th century and traveled a lot, gives us a very precise and to a very large extent accurate outline of the social character of social and professional character of this class. Next, please. Well, this is just to remind you that the two go together. If there are merchants, there are money changers. Next, please. Now, the money changers were essentially money testers or assayers, which enabled them to become money changers. Remember Banarsi Das's statement that you first have to learn how to assay a coin. Assaying is a technical term used for evaluating the extent of metals in the coin. If it's a silver coin, how much of silver? If it's a gold coin, how much of gold? If it's a copper coin also, a low value coin, how much of copper? Because there is always an inferior metal which is combined as alloy when the coin is crafted. And there were degrees of purity of gold and silver. Gold 12 degrees and silver 20 degrees. Barabani is the term used for gold, the purity of gold. And they did it very, very commonly by testing the metal on the touchstone or kasauti. It's a stone, a particular kind of stone, and they rub the coin on the stone and they use a series of needles. On the top of each needle is written the degree of purity of the metal which they are testing, and they make a parallel mark with a needle and compare the two marks. That's how they did what we can call qualitative assaying or qualitative testing of metal, and in this case, of course, coins. The other method was more elaborate. We should not discuss that. It's a trial by fire method. You put the thing in fire and then whatever is left is pure, whatever is burnt is impurity. So as a result of their skill in testing money, they were employed in mints in the Mughal Empire. In the Mughal Empire, all mints were owned by the state. Even though they produced money for the market and not for the state only, the state had a very small contribution in terms of the mint output, but the mint was owned by the state, and the state employed best sarrafs to assay coins. So whenever a batch of coin would come to the mint, the sarraf would start working, because the batch will have all types of coins. Old Mughal coins, regional coins, foreign coins. So they will test, and then on the basis of the amount of precious metal, a balance sheet will be prepared in which the cost and tax of the state called seigniorage would be deducted, and the supplier would be given a figure. Come after a week and take this much of freshly minted Mughal coins. So you can imagine that the job of assayer was very, very important. Not only in the market, of course, in the market it was much widespread and much more a source of regular income for the money changer. But even in places like Minsk, you will find Sarrafs as a sales. Next, please. Now, in the Mughal Empire, if you want to buy something, you'll have to give the exact change. You must be thinking that I'm talking about our own times. But in those days too, you could not give a silver coin for a commodity the price of which was quoted in copper. You first had to change that coin. And that was the prerogative of the money changer. The shopkeeper would not do that. So you have to go to a money changer. Suppose you have one silver rupee. You give that to the Sarraf. The Sarraf will give you back a number of copper coins. And of course will charge his fee or commission. And there is a very interesting account of this in Banarsi Das's autobiography of this kind of money changing. Next, please. Now, there was a variety of coins in the Mughal period. The silver rupiah, actually the one which you see is Sher Shah silver rupiah, but doesn't really make our story any different. Akbar's gold muhar, it was Sher Shah who minted a pure silver coin and called it rupiah in 1540. This is a 1541 rupee coin. Muhar of Akbar of Agra, copper coins called dam or paisa, much more widespread for small items and for still smaller or petty transactions, non-metallic currencies, cowries and almonds. Now all these had fixed rates, and by fixed I mean rates kept on changing, but there was exchange between these that could be effected in the market with the help of the money changer. Next, please. Now, coins were exchanged on the basis of what metal they were. So, if it is silver, it will fetch something like 80 copper coins. If it's a gold, it will fetch something like 10 to 15 silver coins. Weight of the coin was also important. If the coin has lost its weight in wear and tear, in circulation, then the Sarraf will charge a discount called Batta and deduct. So if for a rupee you were getting 80 copper coins, minus 1 as Sarraf's commission, now it will be minus 2 or minus 3, depending on the degree of weight loss. The Sarrafs also imposed a very peculiar practice, charging discount on coins not on the basis of weight but age. All coins had dates. And the moment the year passed, the Sarraf would like to levy a discount or batta, charge a batta, by saying ito purana ho gaya sikka. And the Mughal state resented very much this practice and framed a set of laws. Todarmal was particularly active on this front. But this practice continued. And Tavernier says that since ordinary folk could not read the date on the coin, the sarrafs would cheat them with a heavy discount. Next, please. Oh, sorry. This is the painting that you see is actually a Mughal painting, which is in the BNF Paris of a sarraf. The coins which are put on display on the Bisat are actually Mughal coins. If you zoom in, you can read the inscriptions on the coins. Next, please. Now, the sarrafs did another very interesting job in the market, in the money market. Now, India imported large quantities of silver and gold from outside for the merchandise it exported. This was a long-standing structural basis of India's foreign trade. India exporting commodities and importing gold, silver, and copper, and very little foreign merchandise. The Mughal state had an outstanding policy of allowing only Mughal legal tender to circulate. That is to say, their own coin. No foreign coin was allowed to circulate, except for in coastal areas quietly. Now, the two important coins which were imported in the 16th and 17th centuries were Lari, which was minted in Iran, a very interesting fish hook, double pearl kind of a silver coin with an inscription on it which can be read. Lari Hurmuzi, for instance, is a standard inscription. And dollars or rials of eight, which were all brought from Spanish America, from the silver mine in Mexico and Peru. And the silver part of it was minted in Peru and Mexico. So they were Peruvian and Mexican dollars. And of course, there were Spanish dollars minted in Seville. All this came to India in ships, either European ships or other merchant ships, also in caravans from Turkey to Iran, and from Iran to India. And they were all converted into Mughal coins. Next, please. Now, as I mentioned, the Mughal state owned and operated mints in different parts of the country. This is a unique painting of a Mughal mint, where you can see the operation of the mint, particularly the striking of the dies. A man with a hammer is striking the upper die, and between the two dies is the blank, which we can't see. And the dies have inscriptions cut in reverse. And when the man strikes the upper die with a hammer, the two sides of the coins receive inscriptions. And there are some coins strewn on the floors also. The sarrafs were responsible to a very large extent in facilitating the flow of imported bullion into the mint. They will purchase it and pay the merchant, foreign merchants, or even Indian merchant bringing money from Mocha and Bandar Abbas and other places. And they had their own connections with the mint. They could wait. Usually the mint in high season had a long queue, and merchants were in a hurry to go and buy commodities in the market. So here you have the sarraf who would again act as intermediary between the mint and the merchant. Next, please. Now, the seraphs, apart from dealing with money testing, money changing, and sale and purchase of raw gold and silver or bullion or foreign coins, all were also worked as bankers. And it shouldn't surprise us, because the their ability to handle all kinds of currencies and stay in possession of money allowed them to perform two important tasks on which all kinds of banking institutions are based, even today: accepting deposits and lending money. The two principal functions of a bank is deposit and money lending. And the seraphs accepted deposit from anyone who had surplus cash and paid interest. At the same time, they gave money loans to merchants and consumers on interest which was higher than what they paid on deposits. And the difference between the two rates of interest constituted their profit. A large number of seraphs were bankers. Within the community of seraphs, there was specialization. Of course, not all seraphs would be bankers. According to a Dutch factor on the streets, there was a street, a designated street in Surat, where they will sit with their stools and benches and put their loose change and money testing devices. And of course, they were bankers. So here too, you have a hierarchy in terms of scale of operation, possession of capital, that there were big bankers who could loan a large amount of money. And of course, there were small bankers also. In the countryside, sahukars, epitomized as villains in the films that we watch, Hindi films, who would give loan to the peasant, partly because he had to pay the revenue even before the harvest was done in harsh conditions, partly because of harvest failure, partly because he did not have enough money to buy seeds or cattle or plow. But there was always a money lender in the countryside, sahukar, who would keep a large number of indigent peasants in his debt. Next, please. As a result of their operation of depositing money and lending money, the seraphs, and keeping an account of all this, the seraph also indulge in the business of what we can call, using a modern expression, gyro banking. In gyro banking, depositors would have an account with the seraph, and they could make payment through book transfer by issuing pay orders, like we do using checks today. So, in a very famous incident, a noble who was traveling in a palki was stopped by a soldier who said, "Look, 3 months of my salary is due, and I have been squatting before your house, and you are not paying, so I'm stopping you in the market now. So pay me." And the noble, quietly understanding the sensitivity of the situation and his reputation, wrote a check, a roqa, drawn upon his banker, some kind of an IOU, saying, pay this man this much of money. And the soldier carried that and went to the Sarraf, and the Sarraf accepted the Ruqqa and transferred the money from his credit account to his debit account. So the money was debited or deducted from his holdings in the ledger. This form of transfer is today known as gyro banking, and the Sarrafs also perform. There are numerous examples. Unfortunately, this part of the Sarraf's business is not highlighted very much because of the dearth of the ledgers that would have carried all these disinformation, but they also did gyro banking. Next, please. The Sarrafs specialized in issuing and discounting bills of exchange called hundi. Now, we have already met this instrument when Kharaksen, Banarsi Das's father, issued a hundi. That is to say, he wrote on a piece of paper in a particular way in which hundi was written. That I have taken this much of money from this man, which will be paid on this day or within this stipulated amount of time in Agra. And that hundi is the number two hundi listed here. People borrowed money from Sarraf in one place and collected in another by issuing hundis which the Sarraf accepted. So the hundi which Kharaksen wrote for Banarsi Das to carry his goods to Agra was paid for by Banarsi Das in Agra once he was able to sell a large part of his goods. Hundi in this case was an important credit instrument which people could write and raise credit. The first type of hundi which was more popular was an instrument of remittance of funds like money order. If you do not want to carry money, let us say from Surat to Agra, where you have to go to buy things, textile and other commodities, or indigo from Bayana, very famous commodity, then don't carry cash. Give the cash to the banker. The banker will issue you a hundi which you can encash in Agra and get your money after paying a small fee. So the quality of the hundi was to allow the merchant to travel safely without any risk of getting robbed on the way, and when he reached the destination, he was able to get his money. The Sarraf had their agents and correspondents and partners everywhere, and there was a huge network, a very interesting network, where money and hundi flew in two opposite directions. Hundis were also negotiable instrument. Suppose our imaginary merchant who was traveling from Surat to Agra decided to sell it at Burhanpur. He could do that by paying a small amount as discount, which is the profit of the person who bought his hundi, because the amount would be locked for that stipulated period of time, and therefore to make up for the loss, a small amount was deducted. So if it was a 100 rupee hundi, the man will get something like 98 rupees. And the person who had bought the hundi in his own sweet time will encash it either in Agra or will give it to his agent who will do it. His agent had large number of hundis. Anyway, Now, this negotiability of hundi also gives us a sense of liquidity of capital in an exchange economy, where the capital is circulating and not stopping, and idle capital is not acceptable. Capital costs money in this market, and therefore, if it is locked, you pay. Otherwise, you have to keep it flowing. Next, please. Next, please. Because I know I have very little time now. Finally, the Sarafs dabbled in a very interesting business, which we can call risk sharing. You may have noticed by now that overseas and overland commerce had their own risks. Banditry, calamity, storm, piracy, all kinds of things. For some reason, no buyers in Isfahan for Indian goods. We have had situations like that, and Surat merchants are complaining. It has been a month and there are no buyers for some reason. All kinds of risks could be handled by Sarafs on payment of what we can today call premium. A small amount of money as risk premium. So overland merchandise was insured, and maritime commerce, cargoes on ships were insured. The rates of insurance or premium rates are a very good indicator of assessment, how the insurer assesses the risks. The larger the sailing distance, the higher the premium. The difficult the route, the higher the premium. So there was a very interesting side of this business, which is what actuaries do today in the insurance companies, of assessing how much risk that particular venture carried, and therefore what should be the suitable premium for this kind of for underwriting this risk and giving this insurance. The name of the insurance given was Bima. The term occurs, Professor Habib in his many writing has highlighted the use of the term Bima, although we don't know what it means. There was a time when two of us sat and did a bit of hair splitting on whether the term is from the Persian beam or fear. But the discussion was inconclusive. So if there is a solid piece of evidence, of course, the etymology of the term would be ascertained, but Bima was the term used for insurance, both overland and marine insurance. Finally, the Sarafs combined insurance with money lending. If you are a small merchant in Surat, and if you do not have enough cash, don't worry. We will give you capital to buy goods, and the entire transaction will be insured. We will demand you the money only after the successful completion of your business venture, when you come back. But the rate of premium will be very high, because it will be a combination of both interest rate and risk premium. So this particular kind of risk sharing loan, or called AVOK, or AVOK, if you look at the rates, they are very high. The point is, and I'm now not going into the business of credit insurance, which is very, very interesting but complicated, and maybe we can take it up later. But do remember that the entire business, the entire trade was supported or protected by this particular facility of risk sharing, which the Sarrafs extended. Next, please. I hope this is my last slide. Next, please. Next slide, please. Yeah, so this is my last slide. The entire business operated within the framework of what we can call trust and traditions. This is the human part of the story. Well, the rest of it is school calculation, very sensitive understanding of the market, rise and fall of money and merchandise, political climate, regions, distance, all kinds of calculation. But you have this human side. And I'm not saying these two sides are entirely, I mean, there's a big gap between the two. They intersperse. Trust and creditworthiness, for which the word SAAK was used, integrity and reputation was very important in the market. You can take loan from the market instantly if your SAAK is well established. If it is not, then you have to find a guarantor who will guarantee, that happens even today, who will guarantee the entire repayment of the debt. Credit was valid for three generations. If the father could not pay, the son would. If the son didn't, the grandson would. So the passage of credit for three generations was a well-established practice. When the British introduced the law of limited liability in the 18th century in India, merchants and bankers were very angry because it took away that tradition that they could go and demand the money from the family members. Now, the family can simply say, "Wo to ghar pe nahi hai aaj." You will never find the person. And since there is a law of limited liability, you can only hold that person responsible. Traditionally, the whole family was responsible. The house was responsible. Sometimes debt was recovered through the bizarre practice of squatting outside the house and cursing the family. That if, in case of the death of the creditor, his spirit would haunt the family for many generations. This practice was called dharna, a term which is now has a political connotation now. Disputes were always settled internally through corporate bodies called Mahajan. Mahajan also meant corporate bodies other than big merchants and individuals, or panchayats, and there are very many examples of that. Finally, bankruptcy was rare. An English merchant writes that in India, I'm quite surprised to see that unlike our country, it is very rare for anyone to declare bankruptcy because it is considered to be a big social stigma. Unfortunately, if anybody under pressing circumstances had to declare bankruptcy, that person would light diyas or lamps in front of his house in the manner in which Diwali was celebrated. Hence, you have the term Diwalia for bankruptcy in India. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Najaf Haider, for an excellent lecture. I mean, you covered almost the entire spectrum related with merchants and how the trade was conducted. There are a number of questions, I think because much time has lapsed, it's around 1 hour, 45 minutes have passed. So I won't take all the questions for you. I'll just take a few of them, if you allow me. The first question is by Hasnain Aziz. Mr. Hasnain Aziz asks, did coinage of Sur Empire had any influence on Mughal coinage and trade? And was money called rupees during the Mughal rule also?
Well, first of all, I would like to apologize for taking more time than was allotted to me, and I'm sorry about this.
No, I think that was excellent. Excellent.
We could have had more questions, and let me quickly answer. The only way I can redeem myself is to quickly answer the question. Yes, Akbar inherited the entire currency system of Sher Shah and fine-tuned it. The silver coin, which was given the name Rupiah by Sher Shah, continued to be called Rupiah throughout the Mughal Empire, throughout the Mughal rule.
Right. There is a question by Swagata Lakshmi Pramanik. She wants you to discuss something about the role of Bengal in medieval Indian trade. I think it's a whole topic, but still, if you can very briefly answer it.
Well, generally speaking, there was no such thing as Mughal trade or medieval Indian trade unless you combine the regions. The inland trade was essentially between regions. The regions could be small, like a village or a group of villages, kasba, or a town, or between towns. But essentially, these are all regional trades, if we can use this term. And Bengal played a very important role, particularly in sending textiles, silk, essentially, particularly Qasim Bazar silk in the 17th century to northern India. Of course, there was maritime trade. Ships sailed from Hooghly to Masulipatam or to the Straits of Malacca and further on, bringing rice, textile, and a number of other goods. So Bengal was important both for the internal trade in textile in Mughal India and, of course, for its long distance maritime trade. But one particular commodity which sold very well in places like Patna, Banaras, Agra, and all the way sometimes Surat was silk and muslin. Well, I shouldn't forget muslin, particularly from Dhaka. And there was a peculiar feature of Bengal, which I should mention. In Bengal, interest rates were always higher than northern India and western India.
Right. There are a number of questions by Mr. Nanak Ganguly. The revenue assessment in the Deccan had traditionally been calculated simply by counting the number of ploughs. Murshid Quli Khan, appointed by Aurangzeb, applied the Zabt system of assessment and collection. Was there any resentment initially from the villagers or Amirs when officials went to the villages and measuring the land of the landholders?
See, in places like Bengal, the custom of calculating the plough, which is actually household, and then estimating how much revenue could be collected, without forgetting the land which was owned by the or cultivated by the household. So it's not simply calculation of plough, worked very well if the land was not measured. It was a summary assessment. But as you rightly say, if it is under Zabt, which required measuring land, then of course land had to be measured. And when the land was measured and the cash revenue rate was officially declared, and the villagers and zamindars found that this rate was higher than the rate they were paying, obviously there would be resentment. And they would try to negotiate with the authorities by saying, look, the tax is now high. Conversely, if the ZAP rate is lower, which I doubt very much, the state would always like to keep its receipts high, higher and higher, then of course there will be no problem.
I think Mr. Nanak Ganguly, we would be having a separate lecture on the revenue system, and this particular question does not relate with the topic which Najaf Haider was discussing today, but we will have a detailed answer to that when we have a lecture on that. Now, the second question which Nanak Ganguly asks is, the force with which Portuguese acted was hurtful. Calicut lost its splendor, but in Coromandel it remained unaffected. Is it true that the Gujaratis lost their capital in Portuguese business ventures? Portuguese never brushed up the Safavids in Persia or Ottomans in Turkey, who controlled the head of the Gulf.
Now, if you are talking about the 16th century, which is the Portuguese century, then, of course, the presence of the Portuguese in the Indian Ocean was detrimental to the interest of Western Indian merchants, Gujaratis and others. But do remember that soon the Portuguese realized that it was more useful to tax the passing merchandise rather than monopolize the trade, which they did in the first three decades, buying themselves and not allowing anyone to buy. They realized that if they freed the Indian Ocean to its usual trade then and tax it, which is the pass which they issued, cartas or call, as the Mughals call it. So the cost of the pass or call was such that put together it gave them more revenue. So if you agree with this interpretation, then they did not really hurt the Gujaratis and the Malabaris that much. Of course they carried in their ships Indian merchandise, which they would have carried anyway, but now at prices which they could negotiate forcefully. But beyond that, I don't think the Portuguese disturbed the volume or the share of volume of international trade in the 17th century, they declined and confined themselves to the Deccan and the south, and also switched over to other commodities like diamonds and others. That hurt the interest of the local merchants, particularly merchants on the Coromandel coast, who generally dealt with Golconda diamond and other diamond. But beyond that, there wasn't really much much loss, I should say. They created a lot of havoc, like stopping ships and sometimes confiscating goods, fighting. But their overall impact on the Indian Ocean trade, insofar as the share of the Indian merchants was concerned, was not too much.
There is a question by Zainab Naqvi. Would Professor Haider mention a bit about the practice of deposit banking in Mughal India, as referred to by Sujan Rai, and how it acted as a channel for non-mercantile wealth to enter commercial circles in Mughal society?
Yes, that's very true. The Sarafs attracted a lot of idle capital. Particularly, the social groups which kept their money with the Sarafs are not precisely identified. I suspect many of them, like Pelsart says, were members of the aristocracy. And I have this very unresolved problem that many Mughal nobles who had hundreds and thousands of rupees, cash money in their treasury, did not put it out on interest with the Sarrafs. Very interesting phenomenon. They kept their money in their treasury. And that you can see from the wealth of the when the wealth of a deceased noble was audited and inventory was prepared, you could see that a large amount of cash money was discovered. Had that not been the case, the money would have been hidden in the ledgers of the bankers. So it's very difficult to identify who are the people who are keeping their money. And a large number of people were keeping their money, because there was a case in Agra when suddenly money was demanded by the depositors and the Sarraf had to declare bankruptcy. I suspect it had something to do with the shift of capital from Agra to Shah Jahanabad. When people said, give our money back, we are now moving. We are going to Shah Jahanabad. Because this is the late 1640s incident. So this gives us a sense of who the people were. Surely they were either big merchants themselves who had idle cash, not investing in merchandise, or members of the aristocracy and nobility who were leaving their money with the Sarrafs.
There is a question by Sujit Manji. And Sujit Manji asks, sir, if you kindly tell about the merchants of Dutch East India Company in Chinsura, also their role to modernize the city.
I have absolutely no idea.
Another one by Jyotirmaya Khatri. Could well-off merchants, either Baniyas or Khatris, enter the state bureaucracy or nobility?
The first Khatri to enter the Mughal bureaucracy in a big way was Todamal, who got the title of Raja. This title was not given to anyone. Before that, under the Sur bureaucracy, it was Hemu, who was a Baniya. In fact, a term which is used in Mughal sources for Hemu is Hemu Bakal. So surely there were members of the trading community who excelled. And remember, Hemu was single-handedly organizing the bureaucracy of Adil Shah Sur, who was more interested in singing and dancing. So when Adli was singing and dancing, Hemu was conducting military campaigns on his behalf and winning.
Yeah.
The history of the Mughals in India would have been very different had Hemu won that battle. So these were very talented people like Hemu and Todamal. We read a lot of unhistorical and mythological facts about Hemu these days, which I would urge my serious listeners not to believe. But that does not take away anything from Hemu as a military general and a good administrator.
Right. There's a question by Dr. Sayyid Ali Kazim. So I would like to know as to how the standardization of money being exchanged from Bengal to Central Asia was maintained. For instance, we have the Tankai Secondary and Babris or Rupiah and Paisa of Sher Shah or Asafi coins minted at Thatta on the one side and Shah Rukhis on the other side.
Well, Shah Rukhi was the first coin that was introduced in India by the Mughals. It was a Central Asian coin, a silver coin, lighter than the rupee. I would say, I can't exactly remember the exchange, but I would say half the value of the rupee. It was a thin coin. If you see the two coins, you can clearly see that the thin flan, as is what numismatists would say. And that circulated in a very limited way in northwestern India. John Scott D.L. has written in an essay about the circulation of Shah Rukhis in certain areas which were in control of the Babur, of the army and bureaucracy of Babur, or which had a trading connection with Central Asia because of geographical proximity. So both geography and politics played some part in the circulation of Shah Rukhis. But after that, Shah Rukhi was not used on any large scale. It was used very, very sparingly. And therefore, there was no big problem exchanging. The exchange rate between Shah Rukhi and Rupee was already established in the first quarter of the 16th century anyway. So there was no problem exchanging Shah Rukhi with Rupee. The problem was exchanging Shah Rukhi with coins like Sikandari Tanka, because that was a heavily alloyed coin. It was not a silver coin. It had practically lost its entire silver and had a very tiny component of silver. In fact, it was called Tankai Siyah. The term Tankai Nukhra or silver tanka was no more used for the coins of Ibrahim Lodi and Sikandar Lodi. The term is Tankai Siyah because by now it had practically lost its silver and had become what is called, what numismatists call in French, monnaie noire, or black money.
There is a third question by Nanak Ganguly. Nanak Ganguly this time asks, Professor Heather, the force with which Portuguese acted was hurtful. Calicut lost its splendor.
We had this question.
You had this question?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Then we go to Arusha Mansuri. Ali Heather. In Hyderabad state, coins were minted in the name of the Mughal emperor till 1858. So did all states use to mint coins in the name of Mughal emperor despite the power of Mughal empire dwindled?
No, not really. After the decline of the Mughal empire, regional states start, and in fact, even before that, I should say, after Aurangzeb, many regional states, and this is particularly true of the Marathas, they started minting their own coins. Ranjit Singh had his own coins, which were not Mughal coins. So Hyderabad is a bit of an exception, where Mughal coins were, coins with the name of the Mughal emperor were used. We should also remember that even the English East India Company minted its own money in the name of Shah Alam II with a frozen numismatic date, which was not the real date. So a single date was used for a number of years for which the English East India Company silver rupee was minted. This was done not for political reasons so much as for the reason of customary usage. Money users would be very hesitant to use a new coin in the beginning and will create a lot of chaos in the market. So if there is a transition, the transition has to be done smoothly in a way to inspire confidence in the hearts of money users.
Mirza Hasnain asks you about role of Noor Jahan Begum. He asks, did Empress Noor Jahan play any role in coinage of the Mughal Empire?
Oh, that's a very interesting question. The answer is yes. And I here follow Hodiwala. S.H. Hodiwala has an excellent essay on this. And his theory is, which I am inclined to believe, that in the last 4 years of Jahangir's reign, that is to say from 1624, Noor Jahan started minting coins. When I say Noor Jahan started minting, Noor Jahan was not actually minting. The Mughal mints were minting coins by the order of the king, where the coins had the names of both the king and the queen. Now that was quite extraordinary. Remember, these are not Noor Jahani coins per se. If you read the legend of the coin, the legend says this coin has the name of Noor Jahan because of Jahangir, the king. So actually these are all Jahangiri coins with the name of Noor Jahan in them, but this itself is quite extraordinary. And what Hodiwala argues is that Noor Jahan had it planned very well, that the moment the emperor would say go, she would send her men with the message to start minting coins. And there were four or five mints where the die was already cast with the legend of Noor Jahan. So on the strength of the fact that certain mints immediately started minting money with Noor Jahan's name on them, Hodiwala has argued, and rightly so in my opinion, that Noorjahan had planned it and very well executed the plan.
Right, sir. There is a question by Leher Zaidi. Leher asks, sir, are there good sources that the Jagat states lent large sums to the East India Company, which they used to fund their wars against the Indian rulers, especially Bengal? She says that this has been discussed by Dalrymple in NRK.
Well, that's true. It's true that the Jagat states send large sums of money to the English East India. The Jagat states were bankers. And as we have seen in our discussion, one very important function that the banker does is to lend money on interest. And if you have a client like the East India Company, which is also, which has both trading and political interests, the Jagat states were more than willing to lend money. And this is given in the biography of the Jagat Seth by J.S. Little. There is a biography of Jagat Seth in a book written, if I'm not mistaken, by Little, L-I-T-T-L-E. And in that, you'll find many of these interesting accounts of the transactions of the Jagat Seth. So William's book has an accurate description of this particular aspect.
Right, sir. I mean, although there are many, many questions which are being asked from you, but I would like to take up the question by Sayyid Ali Kazim, Dr. Kazim. Fryer says that without brokers, neither the natives nor the foreigners did any business. How did the money changers or merchants deal with the menace of the brokers?
See, there are two kinds of answers. One is that, much like Tavernier's statement that in India you will hardly find a village where there would be no money changer, Fryer is making this remark with a bit of exaggeration. But that said, the brokers played a very important role in bringing the two parties together. And this was possible not only in the case of those merchants who were new to the market, or not new to the market, but new to a commodity which they wanted to buy for the first time. They would need a broker. There's no doubt about that, because they will have no idea. And sellers in India, the prices of commodities were not organized. The commodities, the prices were charged in many ways. If you have a merchant who you think is new to the market and to the commodity and wants to buy a lot, you can immediately raise the price and there will be negotiations. And the broker played a very important role. In the business of money changers, there weren't many brokers, because money, big money changers, of course, who were buying bullion, might need brokers. So if you have in, let's say, chips have come from Jeddah, Mocha, and Bandar Abbas, and also from Europe, and you have something like 50 ships anchored, and there's plenty of money to be minted in Surat, then surely brokers would be very, very active, in because there will be many, many suppliers of bullion and not those many buyers. So they will sometimes, in fact, although this is rare, they themselves started acting as money changers. So they'll say, give us your bullion and we'll give you freshly minted coins. And then in their own sweet time, they will go and either sell the whole thing to a money changer or go to a mint and get the money minted. So except for this part, the role of brokers in the business of the money changers is far more limited than in the case of sale and purchase of merchandise.
There is a question by Mr. Ali Heder. Do we know names of any famous Muslim accountants of the Mughal period? I am asking this because Muslims are usually sidelined on this profession.
Well, in the 16th century, I would say in the Mughal Empire, most accountants were Muslims. Iranians mostly, but also Central Asians. And this you can find in Akbarnama or any source which deals with the first part of the century. Let us say the first three quarters of the century. Then something interesting happens. Of course, in between, Sher Shah had created this very interesting rule that in every pargana or sub-district, there will be two accountants and not one. One will maintain records in the local language or Hindi, and one in Persian. So there were Karkunane Farsi Navis and Karkunane Hindavi Navis. This system continued under Akbar. And this was first dismantled by Todarmal, who said there is no need for two accountants and we only need one, Persian. So all those Hindavi Navis, Karkunan, or Bitikchis were out. And they were mostly Hindus. Then they started coming back. So much so that they first learned the language. Then they learned the Iranian system of accountancy based on Siyaq, which was new to the country. I mean, new to their own. Remember Tavernier's remark that they keep account in a particular way. So they started learning so much so that by the time we come to the middle of the 17th century, they are mostly Kayasths, but also Brahmins and Khatris. Yet you'll find many small-time Muslim accountants. I can't recall immediately the name of a famous Muslim accountant of the stature of, say, Raja Raghunath, who kept his accounts very, very meticulously. Of course, he was not an accountant. He was actually a minister, but he was basically an accountant. I don't remember the names of any well-known, right now well-known Muslim accountant, but I am very sure that many small accountants in Parganas, small Qasbas, were Muslims. And you can identify them by the term Khaja used for them. The word Khaja was also used for accountants who were not Muslims. But if you find a Muslim name with the word Khaja, then you can possibly think that this man is an accountant.
Are there any reference to Muslim Sarraf?
No. So far, I have not found a single reference to a Muslim Sarraf. This was a business which was practically monopolized by Baniyas and other mercantile groups. I would say Khatris also. There is an account of the Bahamani kingdom which imported Muslim Sarrafs from northern India into the Deccan to, they were either Sarrafs or coiners or minters, because they wanted to introduce their own coin. And in the part of the Deccan where they were ruling, the Vijayanagar Hun or pagoda was very powerful. People were not willing to accept the Bahamani coin, which was modeled on the Delhi Sultanate, but they were more inclined to use the Vijayanagar coins. To handle this situation, they imported a large number of Sarrafs, and if I am not mistaken, Professor Habib has translated this passage from Firishta in his latest book on the economic history of medieval India, of Delhi Sultanate. And if you read the passage, perhaps some relevant information would be. Saadullah Khan was again of the same stature as Raja Raghunath. He was Wazir and Diwan, who knew accountancy very well. He was not an accountant. See, that is the problem. That is the problem I am facing, that all these big wigs who become Diwans and Wazirs are basically, they learn accountancy very well, because they have to read all the papers and match the various accounts. So I would agree with you that Saadullah Khan was very good in accountancy, but he was not an accountant, much like Raja Raghunath.
Professor Najaf Haider, it's been a long lecture and a good discussion. And we would actually stop at that because there are a number of other questions. I think it would be best if we have your comments on the question which was flashed just now by Arusha. What, according to you, would be the takeaway from your lecture today? Your time in telling us a lot about the merchants and the mercantile ways of functioning. So what do you suggest is the major take from what you have spoken?
Well, the first thing I would like to mention as an implication of what we have been discussing is that these 500 years of so-called Muslim rules, Delhi Sultanate and Afghan Empire and the Mughal Empire, with which I am familiar. There is, of course, the story is much wider than this. This is a period of tremendous economic activity and expansion, with phases of retraction and contraction also. But the gradient goes up, and by the time we reach the 17th century, there is tremendous economic expansion. So the first point I would like to mention is that the Indian economy was expanding in these years, and expanding not only in one sector but in many sectors. Exchange economy is particularly expanding. As a result, there are more goods, production of more goods, newer goods, older goods produced in larger magnitude. There are new methods and instruments of transaction to sell goods faster. There is also a monetary system established by the state, which worked very well, which allowed money to circulate in the market in a way to facilitate what we have been calling exchange economy. So we have the picture of a buoyant and vibrant exchange economy and not a stagnant one. I can give you a contrasting example. Max Weber and W.H. Moreland both argued that Indian economy was not capable of expanding, no matter how much hard you work or no matter how much injection of foreign silver, and this is a reference to Spanish-American silver, which came in the 16th and 17th centuries, it will not expand because it's a very stunted, very autarkic kind of an economy. Now, you can critique this particular point of view by looking at the vibrancy. And in this story of vibrancy, the role played by merchants and money changers is tremendous. They flourish. There is no state control over them. They are not taxed, by the way. There is no such thing as corporate tax. Merchants' goods are taxed, but money changers are not taxed. So their income is tax-free. And they flourish and expand and establish their firms. There is hardly a story, except for here and there, of course, of the kind of oppression by the state or by a particular community or class, which W.H. Moreland had mentioned in his assessment of the Mughal economy. The Mughal economy had possibilities of growth, but couldn't grow because of the state, because the state was playing a very negative role. So one major takeaway from the discussion about merchants and money changers is that of the broad expansion of the economy, vibrancy of the economy, and the groups which are propping up the economy, and also a good deal of creative imagination which goes into the making of all kinds of instruments which these groups use to conduct their trade. Within the framework, let's not forget, of family, custom, and tradition.
Well, Professor Daja Feather, it's been an interesting discussion. Let me remind the audience that it was way back in 1940s, and if I remember correctly, then it was in 1944 that Wilfred Cantwell Smith wrote an article in the very famous journal of that period, Islamic Culture, where he tried to argue that there was a very vibrant middle class during the Mughal period. And by middle class, in this particular article, he meant the mercantile classes. And he went on to claim that the efflorescence of the mercantile class was in fact intertwined with the efflorescence of the Mughal Empire. In fact, that was one of the first articles where there was a talk of the existence of a middle class in India. Thank you, Professor Najaf, for elucidating on this topic and not confining yourself only to the categorization of the various types of merchants which existed during the Mughal period. Today, the way you covered this lecture, I think the whole process of how these merchants were working must have become quite apparent and clear to the audiences. I hope and I wish that in one of the following lectures which takes place, we would also be discussing the existence of middle classes in India, of which the merchants were but a part. I won't insist on having this lecture, but in case, I promise that if there is some vacancy and someone drops out at the last moment, then I'll surely pick that topic up, because that is what I have worked for my research, the urban middle classes. But rest assured, Professor Najaf Haider, that when I talk about the professional middle classes in the Mughal Empire, I will leave out the merchants, because you have actually dealt with them in a very detailed fashion. I must thank you again. You were here with us a second time, and I also hope that in future also, if there is a need and if there is a topic, for example, there is one aspect which is still left uncovered by your lecture, and that is the minting of the coins. That is something I remember that you have a beautiful article which you have written along with certain paintings, which shows the process of the minting, which is taking place during the 17th or 18th century. So probably in some future weeks, we would be having Professor Najaf Haider once again with us. And thank you, audience, for keeping joining our programs week after week. And I have already announced for the next week we would be having Professor Shirin Musvi and Professor Irfan Habib with us, and their lectures also would be the second lectures in these series. Thank you very much. Have a good time. Good night.